Welcome back all of you to this digital communication course. Before midterm, you must have studied about different types of modulation schemes and their respective performance analysis. Now in the post midterm course, we'll study another very important aspect of digital communication, that is error correcting codes. It's one of the most important, you can say, the procedure or the block of the overall digital communication scenario. And this error correcting codes is the part of unit number 4 according to your CIF. And our focus will be more on this unit number 4, as it has more practical and direct applications in a digital communication scenario. And while the unit 3, which is carrier and clock synchronization, that consists of several miscellaneous topics, and that will study after unit 4. So first we are going to study unit 4 in this post midterm course, and then we'll move on to the unit 3, and our main focus will be on the unit number 4. We'll cover all the topics of unit number 4 thoroughly, and the important topics of unit 4 includes automatic repeat request, ARQ, linear block codes, and then cyclic codes, then VCH codes, then convolutional codes, jitter-free decoding, and interleaving. So these are the important topics which we are going to cover in unit number 4, and all of these are the different coding techniques which are used to which are used in error detection and correction in the digital communication scenario. So we'll study all the different types of coding techniques which are used in practical digital communication systems to check the error during the transmission of a signal. So let us begin with unit number 4, which is error correcting codes. As the name suggests, in this unit we are going to study about different coding techniques which are used to detect and as well as correct the errors which are included in the signal during the transmission process in the digital communication scenario. So the key to achieve error-free digital communication, we know that if we are talking about any communication scenario, in this case we are talking about digital communication, we have a transmitter, a receiver, and the signal is transmitted through a channel. Channel may be a wired channel or it may be a wireless channel. So during the transmission process, distortion, noise, or interference may be added in the signal. So distortion, noise, or interference. Distortion, noise, or interference may be added in the signal while the transmission process, right? So in case of digital communication system, when we are transmitting the digital signals in the form of ones and zeros converted into appropriate electrical signals and then electromagnetic waves, so due to these distortion or noise interferences, there can be change in the signal. One can be detected as zero, or zero can be received as one, right? So in the key to achieve error-free digital communication in the presence of these distortion, noise, or interference is the addition of a appropriate redundancy to the original data bits. Let's say we have a original data bits which is represented by D. It can be any binary sequence, okay, suppose for example this is a binary sequence, or your original data bits that has to be transmitted from a transmitter to receiver. So the key to achieve error-free digital communication is that we add several redundant bits to this bitstream D. So we add several bitstreams. Okay, so these are the redundant bits that we add to this data bit, which are used for error detection and correction. So this is the key for the error-free transmission, redundant bits, addition of redundant bits. With the help of these redundant bits, we can check the error during the transmission process in the communication scenario. Okay, so there are several coding techniques which are used to convert the digital data bits into a particular code. This entire binary sequence is known as a code. A code consists of what? A code consists of your original data bits plus redundant bits. Right, your code consists of original data bits and redundant bits. These redundant bits are used for error detection and correction. Right, so there are several coding techniques which are used to generate these codes. There are several coding techniques, right? And such coding techniques are known as forward error correcting codes. Forward error correcting codes, or FECs. So in this unit, we are going to study about different types of forward error correcting codes, okay, which are techniques, which are, you can say, different techniques to generate the code bit sequence which consists of your original data bits and the redundant bits. So if we classify this FEC, that is forward error correcting codes, we can categorize this into two important categories. That is, first one is the block codes, and the second one is convolutional codes. These are the two broad categories in which we can categorize the different types of coding techniques, forward error correcting coding techniques. Let us have distinguishing points between these two type of coding techniques, block codes and the convolutional codes. Block codes, as the name suggests, in the case of block coding, we take block of data bits at a time. Okay, like for example, in block coding, every block of k bits, let's say this is we are talking about k bit block, right? This k bit block is encoded into a longer code which consists of n bits, where n is greater than k. That means k bit is the original data bits, we add some redundant bits into it to generate a code word with n bits. This is the process. So we deal with the signal in the form of blocks, right? We add several redundant bits to each block of data. We divide the entire data bit stream into several different blocks of the same length, let's say which is k bits, and we add some redundant bits to each block of data to generate a code word which consists of n bits. Obviously n will be greater than k, right? So we can say that very important thing, that in case of block codes, every unique sequence of k data bits, every unique sequence of k data bits determine a unique code of n bits. That means every block of every unique sequence of k bits which constitute a block, they determine a unique code of n bits. That means with the knowledge of the k bits, we can generate our unique code consisting of n bits. While in case of convolutional codes, the coded sequence of n bits, you can say it depends not only on the k data bit, it also depends on the previous data bits. In case of block codes, this n bit coded sequence depends only on the k bit of data, while in case of convolutional codes, the n bit of coded sequence depends on the k bit of original data, current data, plus the previous data bits also. So we can say that these convolutional codes or encoders also have memory. So you can say these encoders have memory. While there is no memory requirement in case of block codes. So we can simply say that in case of block codes, the k data bits are accumulated and then they are encoded in a n digit code word. As simple as that. In case of block codes, we accumulate k data bits which constitute a block, and then we add several redundant bits to it and it generates a n bit coded sequence. While in case of convolutional code, the encoding is done on a continuous running basis rather than by a block of k data bits. In case of convolutional codes, the encoding is done on a continuous running basis rather than by block of k bits. I am repeating once again, in case of block codes, we accumulate k data bits, okay, that constitute a block. This is a block, and then we add some redundant bits to generate n bit coded sequence. In case of this convolutional code, the encoding is done on a continuous running basis rather than by block of k bits. Alright. So these are the two different categories of the error correcting codes, block codes and convolutional codes. Next we'll have a look at a very important concept, that is redundancy. How redundancy helps in detection and correction of errors. So next we'll look at the topic, that is redundancy for error correction. Okay, so let us first define some variables. First one is code word. Code word is, you can say, n bit coded sequence. You can say that it is a unit of bits that can be decoded independently. So in case of forward error correcting codes, whenever we talk about code word, that means it intuitively means we are talking about a n bit coded sequence, and this n bit coded sequence is a, you can say, independent block which is decoded independently of any interference with the previous or the upcoming block of n bit coded sequence. Alright, so and the number of bits, it consists of n bits, is known as code length. Code length is the number of bits in a code word. So in this case, it is n. Okay. The number of bits in a code word is known as code length. And usually we denote the data bits by k. Okay. So let's say if k is the data bits, which are transmitted by a coded sequence of n bits, is the data bits which are transmitted, by a n bit coded sequence. So we can say that the number of check bits or the redundant bits is how much? N minus k, because k is the data bits and these data bits are transmitted using a n bit coded sequence. So n minus k is what? The number of redundant bits or we call them check bits. N minus k is the number of redundant bits or the check bits. Another important term here is code rate. What is the rate of that code? It is denoted by R, which is equal to k divided by n, where k is the number of data bits, n is the length of the coded bit sequence. So such a code is known as NK code. This is how we represent, this is the representation of this code, NK code, where N is the N bit coded sequence, number of bits that are used in the coded sequence, and K is the data bits. So we can say that the data bits is a K dimensional vector, consists of K number of bits. It is a K dimensional vector while the coded bit sequence is a n dimensional vector, which is c1 c2, consists of n number of bits. It's a n dimensional vector. So initially let us determine the minimum number of the redundant bits or the check bits required to detect or correct any given number of errors in a NK code. Suppose we are given with the NK codes and we want to detect and correct T number of errors. We are going to use same nomenclature throughout this unit. N denote the coded sequence, K denote the bit sequence, the data bit sequence, T denote the number of errors. Now given this scenario, given NK code and T, then these the number of errors that needs to be detected and corrected. So let us determine the number of redundant bits required. That means what should be the value of N minus K to correct or detect this T number of errors bits. Right. So if n is the code length, right? If n is the code length, so due to this n code length, the total number of code words that can be generated is 2^n is the total number of code words. Total number of code words. Right, which are available, right? To assign 2^k number of data words. These are the number of data words. See, k is the data bits. So k is the number of data bits. So the number of data words required is 2^k, and total available code words are 2^n. Right. And suppose we wish to find a code that will correct up to T number of erroneous bits. We wish to find a code which can correct T number of erroneous bits. So in this case, if we transmit, transmit a data word, that is D of J, by using one of the code word, that is C of J. See, the total number of the code words available are 2 raised to power n, and the required data words are 2 raised to power k, right? Suppose we have a data word D of J, which is transmitted using one of the code word, that is C of J, and during the transmission through the channel, some errors occur, and at the receiver end, instead of receiving C of J, we receive C J dash. Okay, so this is the received code word. Due to error. So instead of receiving CJ, which was transmitted, due to error, we are receiving CJ dash. Okay. So if the channel noise causes error in T or lesser number of bits, if the error is in T or lesser bits, we can say that this CJ dash lies in the Hamming sphere. Now I'll tell you what do we mean by Hamming sphere. Hamming sphere, or we can also commonly known as Hamming distance. So if two binary sequence of same length, they differ by j bits, then the Hamming distance between the sequence is considered to be j. For example, we have, let's say, two binary sequence 1011 and 1001. Okay, these are the two binary sequence of same length. The length is 4 bits, right? And they differ by only a single bit. Okay, so the Hamming distance in this case will be, Hamming distance is 1. Okay, so this is it is a very convenient way to map the binary sequences. Okay, so this is the important terminology that we use to map the binary sequences. So we are seeing that if the error is in T or lesser number of bits, then CJ lies in the Hamming sphere or within the Hamming distance. Alright. That means we can say that, let's say this is the Hamming sphere. At the center we have the transmitted code word C of J, and this radius denote the number of errors that can be tolerated. So if the received code word, the received code word CJ dash, which is CJ dash, it lies within this Hamming sphere, that is, if let's say CJ dash lies somewhere over there. If CJ dash lies within this Hamming sphere, then we can say that the receiver decide that the true transmitted code word was CJ. The receiver decides in favor of CJ. I hope I am making sense. This is the Hamming sphere. At the center we have the transmitted code word C of J, and T is the number of bits which can be detected erroneously, or which includes error while the transmission is taking place, and CJ dash is the received code word. So if CJ dash lies within this Hamming sphere, that means the error is within the tolerable limits, then we can say that this CJ dash, this is the received code word, it can be detected as C of J if CJ dash lies within this Hamming sphere. Okay, so by this scheme we can say that it is capable of correcting T number of error bits. This is the Hamming sphere, and we can say that if the received code word lies within this Hamming sphere, of radius t, centered at C of j, then we decide that the original transmitted code word was C of j, and this scheme is capable of correcting t number of errors. This scheme is capable of correcting t error bits, and another important thing to note over here is that d minimum, which is the minimum distance between t error correcting codes, without overlap is, if we look at the minimum distance between the different error correcting codes without getting overlap, is d minimum should be equal to twice of t plus 1. Let us see the logic behind this. Let's say this is a Hamming sphere and this is the center. Let's say this is the first error correcting code. The radius is t. Okay. And let's say this is the second Hamming sphere, which is centered around the second error correcting code C2, and again the radius is t. And let's say this is the third C3. Okay, so the minimum distance between the two error correcting codes without any overlap should be what? T plus 1. That should be the minimum distance between the two error correcting codes, so that there is no overlap in the Hamming spheres, and at the receiver end we can easily detect the transmitted code word. So this is the minimum distance between the two error correcting code words, so that we can easily detect, there is no overlap and we can easily detect the transmitted code word. Another important, this is one of the important relationship that you should remember. Another important relationship is that n is equal to 2 raised to power m minus 1, where n, you already know, it is the code length of the code word. M is nothing but d minimum. We are just giving another name to m. So this n is equal to 2 raised to power m minus 1, and so accordingly k is equal to 2 raised to power m minus 1 minus m. These are the two important relationships. So with the help of these two important relationships, we can define any Hamming code as 2 raised to power m minus 1 comma 2 raised to power m minus 2 raised to power m minus 1 minus m comma m. This is how we define a Hamming code. One of the most well-known Hamming code is 743, where value of m is 3, and we can easily find out the rest of the two terms, which is n and k. This is n, this is k, and this is your m, which is d minimum. This is how we define a Hamming code. I'm repeating once again. See, starting from here, d minimum is the minimum distance between the two error correcting codes. And logically, if you look at this minimum distance, it should be 2t plus 1, where t is the number of errors during the transmission process. So if you look at a Hamming sphere, this is a Hamming sphere. If it is centered around a code word C1 and t, which is the radius of this sphere, is the number of error bits, right? And C2 is, let's say, another code word, the distance between, the minimum distance between these two, so that the two spheres don't overlap, should be 2t plus 1. That should be the minimum distance. So this is d minimum. This d minimum is also represented, used somewhere as the variable m. Another important relationship is n is equal to 2 raised to power m minus 1, where n is the code length of the code word, m is d minimum, and k, which is the length of data bits, is equal to 2 raised to power m minus 1 minus m. And hence, we can define a Hamming code. This is the way of representing a Hamming code, is 2 raised to power m minus 1, which is n, 2 raised to power m minus 1 minus m, that is k, and m. It is alternatively n, k, m. And 743 is one of the well-known Hamming code that is used in the digital communication scenarios. See, the another way of correcting error is to design a code to detect, only to detect up to t errors, not to correct, only to detect, which is the method that is ARQ, automatic repeat request. It is an alternate way to correct errors. Errors by designing a code to detect errors up to t errors, and we are only detecting, not correcting. So whenever the receiver detects an error, it can request a retransmission. In case of ARQ, whenever the receiver detects an error, it can request for a retransmission. This mechanism is known as automatic repeat request. So because error detection require a fewer number of redundant or check bits, and these codes operate at higher rate efficiency. One of the important advantage of ARQ is that ARQ involves only detection of error. And when the error is detected, receiver requests for retransmission. It will keep on requesting for retransmission until it receives the correct bit. Okay. So ARQ involves only detection of error, and the advantage is that the detection requires, the detection process requires only fewer number of bits, fewer number of redundant bits rather, redundant or check bits. Thus, the overall code length will be less, the value of n, that is the code length, n will be less. Thus, we can save upon the bandwidth. This will improve the bandwidth efficiency of the system. But also it have several demerits that we are going to discuss further in this unit. Now, since we are talking about the detection of errors only. Not, we are not concerned about the correction process. We are concerned only about the detection of errors. So to detect T number of errors, the code words needs to be separated by a Hamming distance of at least T plus 1. In case of error correction and detection and correction, it was D minimum was 2T plus 1. While in case to detect T number of errors, the code word needs to be separated by a Hamming distance d minimum equal to t plus 1. Let us look at the logic behind this, why the Hamming distance in case when we have to only detect the errors is t plus 1. See, suppose a transmitted code word is CJ and it contains alpha error bits, alpha number of error bits, where alpha is less than equal to T. Okay, T is the maximum number of errors that can be detected, right? So if CJ was transmitted and it consists of alpha error bits during the transmission process and alpha is less than equal to T, and CJ dash is the received code word, so the number of errors in CJ dash is in alpha number of bits, right? Now since alpha is less than equal to T, so we can say that CJ dash can never be any other valid code word. Clearly we can say that CJ dash cannot be any other valid code word, since all the code words are separated by at least T plus 1, right? And alpha is less than T, that means, let's say we have two code words C1 and C2. We are saying that the minimum distance between these two is T plus 1. Okay. And CJ is transmitted, let's say C1 is transmitted, and the received version is C1 dash. It lies somewhere between here, right? C1 dash lies over there. And C1 consists of alpha number of errors, and alpha is less than equal to T, so it will obviously lie between these two, C1 and C2. So the point is, this C1 dash can never be any other valid code word, C2 or C3 or C4, since all the code words are separated minimum by T plus 1, and the separation between these two, C1 and C1 dash, is less than T plus 1. I hope I am making my point clear over here. So thus the reception of CJ dash immediately indicates that an error has been made. Our purpose is to detect an error. So whenever we are receiving CJ dash, the reception of CJ dash immediately indicates that an error has been made, and our purpose is only to detect the error. Thus the minimum distance, this D minimum, should be T plus 1 when we have to only detect the errors. Okay. Another important point that we need to consider over there is, while dealing with all the type of coding techniques, we make use of modulo 2 addition. Which is defined as 1, modulo 2 addition 1 is equal to 0, and 0 equal to 1, and this is also known as XORing process. I hope all of you are familiar with XOR operation in digital logic. So that the modulo 2 sum of any binary digit with itself is always 0. Modulo 2 sum of any binary digit 1 with 1 or 0 with 0 is always 0. and with different bits it is 1. So all the addition in the you can say the mathematical development of binary code presented henceforth will be modulo 2. So all the additions that we'll discuss starting from the first modulation, coding technique, will be modulo 2 additions, that is XORing operations. Whenever we say addition, that is we are talking about the XORing operation. So that is all for this video lecture, the first introductory video lecture. And from the next, in the next video lecture, we'll begin with the linear block codes. We'll begin with linear block coding techniques. Thank you.